Hey guys, welcome to Sled Talk. Appreciate you guys tuning in. I would like to take a second of your time and introduce this season's title sponsor is Bikeman Performance. So they've decided to jump on board and help push the podcast. And if you're unaware, Bikeman is the elite level when it comes to aftermarket performance parts on your sled. So be sure to check out their site, link in the description. And without further ado, let's jump into the show.
Let the band play.
100K on the Patek Philippe, living life with no regrets.
I can't
designer when I get dressed.
Hey.
Summertime on winter fresh.
Fresh.
I put her legs behind her head.
Oof.
Night night she gonna bed.
Bye bye.
Every day it's a new test. I just keep chasing these checks. Living life with no regrets. Living life with no regrets. Living life with no regrets. Living life with no regrets.
Awesome, Sled Talk listeners, welcome back to part two of the Dustin and Klim podcast. Last one was pretty good time frames, like 2 hours. So let's just jump right into this. We got Dustin back on for this and Kobe again as well. And let's kind of just pick up where we left off. So I want to talk, Dustin, a little bit about Avalanche Alliance, right? And so what that means to you, what's the purpose of it, how the idea even came to be, what your involvement in it is. Just take us through the whole story of how that all got started.
Yeah. So it's really kind of the brainchild of John Summers, who's our VP of marketing. He's my boss. And I mean, it kind of happened over time, but where it started really for me was, I got an Abbey. And I'd never been in an Abbey. And we ride some the Wyoming range is pretty aggressive.
Mm. Care to elaborate on that at all, your Abbey experience? Unless it's
yeah, no, I can tell the story. So me and my normal riding group up in our normal riding area, ridden there 100 times.
Okay.
We were coming out a little bit late. It was dusk. There was another group of guys in there that we kind of had been riding with, guys we know really well. They were a little bit ahead of us. We were literally we call it relay. It's a spot where you drop into a canyon and you can either choose to go left or right.
Mm-hmm.
You got really good zones on each side. So we were getting back to relay to kind of get up to the bump trail to get in. And my three buddies were behind me. One of them was pretty close to the side of me, and the two more were a ways back. And we're just kind of trying to get out of there quick because it's dusk and it's getting cold, and we try to get back to the truck usually by dark.
Yeah.
And I see just out of the corner of my eye like this, like the wind had just blown this crazy snow-like cloud,
mm-hmm.
right? And it kind of catches my attention, and I just look over enough to see a huge wall of just big, like it was an Avy. Like you could tell it was an Avy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that sucked was I was headed into a terrain trap.
Okay.
And my buddy that was right next to me, so I stopped and I'm like, dude, you gotta try to run out of this. Cause if even if you pull your bag, it's gonna put you in that trap.
Yep.
Explain
what a terrain trap is for.
Yeah.
A terrain trap is basically a valley or an area where the snow doesn't really have a lot of place to go, so it piles up really deep. It can't spread out.
Got it.
So I just remember thinking, you got to side, like you've got to angle out of this to get away. I didn't have that far to go. I really only needed 100 yards.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to angle it pretty aggressive. So I keep my right hand on the throttle, and I'm wearing an Avy bag. I'm reaching for the handle, and I was so focused on getting outrunning it that I kept missing the handle.
Okay.
It was bumpy. Mm-hmm. I was trying to hold on, grab the handle. Anyways, and I was able to outrun it, like no problem. It didn't really hit me. I kind of stayed in front of it. Turn around, look back. My buddy also was able to outrun it.
Okay.
So we get down to the bottom, and I turn back, and I'm thinking, where's Brett? Where's Ryan? And so first thing I do, I look back. I can't see him. And I'm everything goes like instantly, like to the worst possible. You know, they're under the snow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, sure. So it's just the three of you? Is that your total?
There was four total, me okay. and three others.
Okay.
And I couldn't see Brett or Ryan.
Okay.
And they were a little ways behind us, and there were some trees and some stuff. And so I get on the radio, and I'm like, Brett, dude, where are you at? I need you to, you know, where are you at? I'm kind of freaking out.
Sure,
like,
sure.
You got to answer me right now. Nothing. Get back on. Brett, dude, talk to me. Like, where are you at? Nothing. And, dude, that freaking sucked.
Mm-hmm.
It sucked big time. Like, yeah. So we buzz around, and I know I got to get to, he's like, I'm pretty sure, I'm hoping he's on the other side of the trees, because there's kind of, I can't see on the other side of the trees. Mm-hmm. And so anyways, John and I flip around, we head around the other side of the trees, and I see an Abbey bag on the snow. It had pushed him off his sled. He was about 40 or 50 yards from his sled. He got his Abbey bag pulled, and he was not super buried, like just his legs. And even he was kind of had him out in front of him, so they really weren't even buried that bad, to the point where he could just kind of brush him off and like basically get himself stood up.
Okay.
And so I get there, and he's not quite out of it yet, but he's kind of getting to the point where he can about stand up. But I mean, it had scared, you know.
Oh,
sure. It shook him up,
yeah,
a little bit.
Yep.
So he's just kind of sitting there, and then Ryan was right next to him. He didn't really get buried or anything. He didn't have his bag pulled, but Ryan was just getting over to him. And we later found out that that other group that we'd kind of been riding with that day, they had side-hilled across the top of their... They were in front of us, but one of their guys was above us.
Mm.
And there's a rock ledge, and you can go up through the rocks and get up on top, or you can stay right under the rocks. Well, he had side-hilled up to right under the rocks, which, and I've put a lot of time and effort into Avi training now, we know is like there's a release point there, right? Like there's not a lot of, once you get up next to the rocks, there's not a lot to hold the snow there.
Right, sure.
And it's an area, and we hear this all the time. Oh, I've never seen that slide. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
Dude, I'd never seen that slide ever.
Yeah.
In 12 years of riding there, I'd never seen it slide. And it was a pretty good size slide. I mean, size wise, the deposition pile was probably 70 yards by 200 yards wide.
Jeez. Okay.
70 feet yep. or 70 yards long by 200. And I would say there were spots where it was probably 7 feet deep.
Good Lord.
So, I mean, it's not huge, but it's
still,
it's enough decent. To bury somebody and could be pretty bad.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That was in 17, I think. I was riding my black 16 Axis. Pretty sure that was 17. Yeah. So then 18, you know, through discussions with John, I was talking to John, and it just so happened that Brett is John's cousin and Justin's cousin, the founder.
Mm-hmm.
There's all the Summers boys are related that, you know, kind of have something to do with the company. So,
mm-hmm.
We just started talking about like, and the hard thing is, dude, I'd have told you I knew what I was doing. Like I'd have said, I've been to Avi trainings. I've been to these dealer open houses. I've been to these evening presentations or whatever, you know, that they're supposedly Avi trainings. I've been to 8 or 9 or 10 of these. I've been riding for 20 years. Like I feel like I know what I'm doing.
Sure.
Right. And I could not have been more wrong. I mean, just straight up. Mm-hmm. Like I was super naive, probably a little arrogant and cocky about it.
Sure.
Like I didn't know. And real life just slapped me in the face hard.
Good for you for recognizing that and admitting it too.
So we just realized, you know, John and I were talking and there'd been a couple other discussions like, what are we going to do to change this? Because I'm not the only one that's in this position.
Right.
I mean, yeah, I've been in this industry a long time, but there's a lot of other people that ride a lot. They don't necessarily have to be in the industry and they think that they're either, it's not a real, you know, they're not worried about avalanches or they don't understand how big of a problem it can be or how risky it is, or maybe they just don't care. But for whatever reason, the majority of mountain riders seemed to have the mindset that it's I don't need training. Mm-hmm. Right. And, or it hasn't been a high enough priority to stop and go get some training.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought, all right, we've got to figure out a way to help change riders' mindsets. And since then I've learned a lot about the human factor and decision making and mindsets. Yeah. And I still have a ton to learn, but
sure.
We realized real quick that somehow we got to get riders to recognize that you need to deal with this. Mm-hmm. Like, you need to prepare yourself. You need to get some education. You need to at least understand what the risk is. So the Avalanche Alliance was created as a way to really accomplish two things. One, it takes money to create communication and events and things like that to change mindsets, right?
Yes.
So we needed to create some kind of a fundraiser. Mm-hmm. And then two, we wanted to create a messaging system that would allow us to get in front of riders and create some awareness talks. Not trainings. We weren't qualified to train. Mm-hmm. And you can't really train in a showroom or in a dealership anyway.
Right.
It's got to be on the snow.
Yeah.
So we knew that we needed to create some awareness trainings to get riders motivated and to get them to be like, holy crap, this is real. I need to change my way of thinking. I need to get some training. I need to be more, whatever that is, it gets them kind of that slap in the face, right? Mm-hmm. Without getting in a slide.
Yeah.
For me, it took getting in a slide. And we don't want other people to have to go through that. And then on top of that, there's been so many stories since then. I mean, we lost Rob Kincaid.
Yep.
We lost Josh Roth. We lost Dave Shepard 20-something years ago, Toby's dad. There's all these other Avalanche tragedies that we can cite that are friends or, industry members that are horrible. I mean, absolutely just heartbreaking horrible.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, dude, no, if we can even just save one person, then it's worth it.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So then we decided to put together, we didn't really know how to do it or what we were doing. We were just kind of winging it. But we decided that we could put a fundraiser together, get a snowmobile, sell raffle tickets, and then use that money to pay for an awareness tour, maybe put up some beacon check stations at trailheads, like just make a difference somehow.
Mm-hmm.
We just didn't really know how, but we knew we needed to do something.
Yeah.
So the first year we bought a Polaris. Polaris helped us a little bit, but we bought a Polaris. We called all of our contacts in the industry, which was super easy. The minute we told anybody fundraiser, they're like, yeah, what do you need? We'll give it to you. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, so many people, SLP kicked in, Zebros kicked in. The first year, I mean, I think we had like 20 something sponsors on the sled.
Mm-hmm.
SLP kicked in a ton of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Zebros kicked in a ton of stuff. Ice Age kicked in a ton of stuff. Arctic FX kicked in a wrap. I mean, we had, Dan helped with the project. And anyways, that sled, we ended up raffling, and I think we were like 55,000 the first year.
Mm-hmm.
And so we used that money to buy beacon check stations. We paid for some avalanche training for a few people, and then we used it to go out on the road and create these Avalanche Alliance awareness presentations.
Yep.
So Matt Antz was pretty passionate about it. He's been in a couple slides and he's learned, he's a really good advocate. Dan, same thing. So we teamed up with Dan and Matt to create our first avalanche presentations. Matt's a trainer. Dan's also, he's not an ARRI trainer, but he's very knowledgeable and does some avalanche training.
Mm-hmm.
So the first year we did, 15 or 20 Avalanche Alliance awareness stops,
mm-hmm.
dealers. And it went really well. People were really receptive. People were thanking us. I had no idea.
Sure.
We got some people to go sign up for training, and we created the Avalanche Alliance website has some resources on it. There's a couple tabs at the top. One of them is providers, and that's who offers motorized specific training. So we made a list, and we didn't care who it was. I mean, like, we just want people to get training.
Yeah.
Right. So it didn't matter if they were climb people or not. It's like, Tyler's Backcountry's on there. Brett Rasmussen's on there. Matt's on there. Dan's on there. Mike Duffy's on there. Anybody that had a motorized training that we could find that we felt like was a credible source.
Mm-hmm. Is this avalanchealliance.com?
Avalanche-alliance.org.
Okay.
Is the website.
Got it.
So then we also had another tab that's the forecasts. So you click on that tab and it'll take you to the US forecast or the Canada forecast. You can pick.
Depending. Yeah.
And then you can zone in, like say you're going to Togedy, you can see, you can click on Togedy and it'll bring up the Togedy forecast, right? It's zonal. So that was another resource we wanted to make it easier for people to find.
Mm-hmm.
And then the tab, there was a tab to win the raffle. You could go buy raffle tickets on there. So that was the first year. Second, third year were very similar. We built another sled, got more partners, got more attention, you know, did it earlier, launched it at Heydays. The second year, I think we were 130,000. Then the third year, last year, we were 178,000. And then this year, the grand prize is a brand new Ford F-350 Super Duty with a few better, you know, wheels and tires and lift and just some cool stuff. We're calling it like the ultimate sled hauler.
And that's actively going on right now.
Right? That's right now, yeah. That'll end the week after Jackson. So we'll draw the week after Jackson. We'll take that truck to Jackson and put it on display.
Okay.
So
just talk a little bit about how people could get entered to win.
So if you go to avalanchealliance.org, there's a tab right at the top that says win this truck.
Okay.
And then you can buy raffle tickets. Of course, the more you buy, the better chance you have. We're not supposed to call it a raffle. It's a sweepstakes.
Okay.
There's some gaming laws and some things that we learned.
Yeah. Huh?
Accidentally.
Yeah.
We kind of got we didn't know when we first started doing this. And
yeah.
Some Karen turned us in like, hey, these guys are, I can't enter for free. I got to buy a ticket. And so the Idaho Gaming Commission called us and was like, you know, you can't do this, right? And we're like, no. And they're like, yeah, you got to have a, you know, self-addressed stamp envelope, you know, no purchase necessary, blah, blah, blah. So we learned some hard lessons.
Sure.
Now we have a third-party company that manages the sweepstakes for us. Yeah. It keeps it all legal and makes sure everything's, you know, that way. So that's been a good thing for us. But we're in our fourth season. We did, I think last year we did 29 awareness stops. This year we did like 18.
Mm-hmm.
It's really cool. I mean, you get a dealership the dealers that we partner with to do these, they've got some skin in the game. I mean, they spend some money to make this happen.
Yeah.
They'll usually give discounts on avalanche equipment that evening only.
Oh. As an incentive to check.
And, you know, it's been hard to get Avi bags the last 2 or 3 years. So the fact that anybody would discount an Avi bag, that's like huge.
Yeah.
You know, and so there was some motivation for consumers to show up, both to get, you know, some more awareness, but also there were some pretty good deals.
Yeah.
Right. And so these dealerships, they really stepped up. And it was cool. I mean, they'd put 150 chairs out. Fill the dealership with chairs, and there wasn't one empty chair.
People standing, too.
People standing in the back, asking really good questions, sharing stories. You know, in the dealership at the end of the day, it needs to be a win-win, right? Like, they need to make money. They've invested into it. They'd come back, and they'd be like, man, we had a great night. This person, we've been trying to get him to buy a bag for 5 years. They finally, you know what I mean? Like, you're making a difference. You can tell.
Totally.
It's changing some mindset, right?
Mm-hmm.
Have we saved a lot? I mean, I don't know. I don't know. It feels like it's helping. You know, you talk to these people that do avalanche training and they're like, yeah, our classes are full. Like, we're booked.
Yeah.
And so I think that's a part to a lot of the avalanche awareness. That's not just us. There's other people that are doing avalanche awareness. You know, Mike Duffy's doing some avalanche awareness and some other companies. Aerie now has their own awareness program. So I think the messaging that avalanches are real and it's important and people need to educate themselves, I think, is becoming more mainstream a little bit. It's not kind of that voodoo, don't talk about it. If I ignore it, it's not a problem type thing now. Mm-hmm. Like, people are starting to realize that, okay, these snow machines will get me in trouble really fast. 10 years ago, it wasn't as big of a problem. I guess I better acknowledge this, right? Mm-hmm. We did some of these awareness presentations, you know, and we talk about the bad things that can happen and we tell some sad stories and things like that. And you kind of feel like it's like all doom and gloom, like the backcountry is so dangerous. Like, we don't want people to think they shouldn't go in there.
Yeah.
But the reality of it is we finally realized it's just like driver's ed.
Sure.
So you get, you turn 15 and they show you these scary movies about people that die in automobile crashes, and they show you all these statistics and
school brings the broken down car.
Yeah. You know, and they do the mock.
Yeah. They got the
crash.
Yeah, they got the deadbeat. Yeah.
And it's pretty doom and gloom, right?
Yeah.
And they're just trying to scare you into being a smart driver. Yeah. The reality of it is the chances of you driving a car are like next to nothing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, avalanches are kind of the same way. It's no different than driver's ed. The risk is there and it's real. And yeah, we're going to kind of tell you doom and gloom and like you need to prepare yourself. But at the end of the day, it doesn't mean you shouldn't go into the backcountry.
Yeah. No.
It doesn't mean you shouldn't drive a car.
Right.
You're still going to drive to work. You're still going to drive to your vacation or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Same with the backcountry.
Yeah.
Like, wear your seatbelt, wear your avalanche bag, you know, don't pull out in front of people, you know, don't go in avalanche. I mean, there's all these things we learn that are not unlike learning how to drive.
Yeah.
And so the purpose of the Avalanche Alliance, again, it's to change the mindset of people who are in the backcountry and try to make people safer. We don't want to see tragedies. life changing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just not, for most of us, it's just not worth it.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to lose my kid. I don't want to,
mm-hmm.
we don't want people to lose their parents.
Mm-hmm.
I know Dave McClure real very well. And I've kind of gotten to know Riley a little bit lately.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't really talk about it a lot. I mean, Dave, I think Dave would like to, but it's hard.
Sure.
But losing Rob was a bad deal.
Mm-hmm.
Not that anybody else wasn't a bad deal, but
sure.
He was just public enough that it kind of, it shook the industry up pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
I think about any of us would give about anything to have him back.
Yeah.
but, you know, Rob, I think just from how I knew Rob, I think Rob would want us to tell his story so that people don't have the same tragedy.
Yeah. You know? Sure.
That's kind of where the Avalanche Alliance is at. We're in our fourth year. You know, we're giving away a big grand prize. That pickup is huge.
Yeah.
You know, $100,000 grand prize.
Yeah.
there's other prizes too. First prize is a Marlin sled deck.
Yep.
Second prize is a full climb outfit head to toe. Third prize is a full fly outfit. And that's the other thing too. Dude, we got competing companies working together on this deal.
That's how serious it is.
You know, and I respect the guys that fly. I've known those guys my entire career. When I worked at SLP, they were one, you know, we were a supplier for them.
Mm-hmm.
Got to know the snow team really well. Great people over there. And, you know, it's awesome to have those guys on board because they care as much as anybody else.
Yeah.
Right? Last year, we gave away a Lynx from BRP.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, Polaris and Skidoo are competitors, right?
Yeah.
But who cares? Like, at the end of the day, none of us want our customers to die.
Yeah, no.
And Lynx helped us with, they helped us big with the sled. They didn't give it to us, but I mean, it was a big deal.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
We had one of the, Lynx was first, you know, it was the first year in the country, so that was cool.
Yeah.
And we were giving one away. So, you know, it was really neat to be able to work with BRP and the Skidoo and Lynx teams and, it's something that brings the industry together for sure.
Yeah.
So I spent my last week, I went to Togedy and got my pro, well, I don't know if I passed yet. I won't find out for like another week or two. I think I did. But I spent a week, doing the pro one certification, which is what you have to have in order to become an instructor.
Okay.
There's a couple other classes you got to have too, but, that was the bulk of it, you know, learning the snow science and terrain selection, understanding terrains.
Mm-hmm.
And, it was awesome. I mean, there's a lot of nerdy stuff in it.
Yeah.
But it was good for me. And it also shows me that I still have a ton to learn.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, so I'm at a pro one, big deal. Like, these guys, they know so much. These people that teach these pro level, they have years and years and years and years of experience. And I mean, I'm just like, man, I got so much to learn. Like, mm-hmm. these guys understand this stuff so good. And I'm getting it, but I need to practice. And most people, I don't think going a level of a pro one makes sense. It's unless you're going to work in the industry.
Yeah.
But getting a rec one and even a rec two.
Mm-hmm.
You, if you're in the ski industry, most of the time, if you don't have any avi training, they won't ski with you.
Yeah.
I'm not from the ski industry, but I mean, right. I have friends that they say, look, we show up to a mountain. You don't have like a level one training.
Mm-hmm.
You're not in our group.
Yeah.
Like you, I need you to save me if something happens or keep me from making a bad choice. And if you haven't been trained to do that, mm-hmm. I'm not riding with you.
Yeah.
Or I'm not skiing with you.
Yeah.
So the culture and the mentality, they're quite a ways ahead of us. We got a lot of work to do.
Yeah. Yeah. So what's, that you haven't done already? What are some of the things that, you know, you guys are in the think tank or in communicating about ideas, ways to keep pushing it? Cause one thing when you're talking about all that I thought of was, and I had this conversation when I took my Avi course with Wallowa Avalanche Center, the first thing I thought of, was like the social media side and making videos. And even like I talked to the Wallowa Avalanche Center about trying to figure out a way that we could go and film a class. Because obviously nothing is going to compare like it is to be physically on the snow. Mm-hmm. But being able to talk to, especially the younger generation that is on the social all the time, that, you know, just expanding the awareness, and making courses like video courses or something, is there anything like that that's in the works that you guys have tossed around?
So
trying to figure out just to expand outside of like, obviously the best is
yeah, what
you
know, all,
to go
what
on the snow options. And then go to a dealership. And then, you know, how can you introduce them to those by more social presence or is,
yeah. Good question. There is actually some existing things already out there. Okay. So there's a program called, I believe it's called Backcountry Ascenders.
Mm-hmm.
And it's basically an online avalanche training.
Okay.
I went through it a couple of years ago, and there's a lot of really good information on there. About as much as you can really kind of try to pick up.
Sure.
Without being on the snow.
Yeah.
You just can't replace on snow training.
No, absolutely.
But there's a lot of resources, even without taking a class. There's several books that are specifically about avalanches. Mm-hmm. They had us read one called Yin and Yang. Or Yin Yang and You, I think. And then they had some other publications that we had to go through for our level one, and we would read sections of each one of those publications. But skiers, you talk to a skier, and a lot of them have read multiple books just on their own without taking any avi training. They just read the books, right?
Yeah.
And then they practice it while they're in the field. A Google search will come up with lots of stuff in a short amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
But I still... I'm a big advocate for on snow training.
Yeah.
Because I want to use the experience of my other snowmobile industry experts to teach me faster.
Yeah.
You know, I get around Matt and Dan and I haven't had the opportunity to be around some of these other trainers. I've been around Duffy a little bit. But the guys from Tyler's Backcountry, and then there's some guys down in Utah. Well, there's Will Mook, Matt Shebohm. They do a really good job. I took a level one from them. The Backcountry Institute down in Utah does some stuff. Any of those guys are going to be able to speed up your learning process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Canada, same thing. We work with Pirates. They have a pretty awesome training program. Julianne Chapman, she's got some avi training stuff. In fact, Avalanche Canada, they're a little ways ahead of us. They have,
okay.
I think, a little more organized programs. They've been doing it a little longer. Canada has a more unified program where we kind of have several different... We've got AAA, but then we've got several other organizations that are trying to do training.
Mm-hmm.
That they're not all exactly the same. And I'm sure. It's not necessarily bad, but it's just harder for people to navigate and understand.
Yeah, understand. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Gotcha. Kobe, did you have any questions about the avalanche stuff?
Not much. That stuff scares me. And I think that's one of like the bad things too. Is it's like it's almost so scary. It's like I feel like there's a lack of talking about it. You know. So I don't know. It just stuns me talking about avalanche stuff. It's scary.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is scary. And what's more scary is when you get slapped in the face by it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've unfortunately been in one or two, and it makes my palms sweaty just thinking back on it right now. And I think that I've had a lack of experience, like you were saying earlier. You know, at one point you were like, oh, you think you know how to use it. You know you don't. And I think my thing is just kind of getting priorities straight, you know, finding a class, finding a good time to do it. I don't know. I've never taken a class, so I am that. I'm still on like the don't know that much, you know, basis. I got the Avi bags and I got the beacon, you know, I make sure I wear it and all that. But then it goes back to the deal. It's like, man, I feel like there's only one person that I know that would actually truthfully know how to use one in our group, and that's probably you.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that sucks, and I'm not trying to give you a hard time, but what if he's under the snow and you got to save him, and you don't have the training and he does?
That's what I always say.
That's the scary thing.
I'm like, make sure that we're not going up at the same time, you know, because you're the only one that's going to know how to do this, you know, and it's scary. And so
after I took my first level one, I came back in my riding group. I'm like, you guys are going to get trained. Oh, we're not going to. I'm like, no, you don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not riding with you if you don't get trained.
And see, that's the level of conviction that you have to have with those individuals in that riding group. Because there's just like, there's no excuse, I feel. And it can be hard to have that conversation, but the severity or the risk or the chances, I mean,
it's a lot harder to go home from a buddy's riding trip and have the conversation with the parents that one of them ain't coming back.
Yeah. And so that I think too is something that also needs to have more awareness around, is the importance of having that conversation. And I feel like if you are going to hold yourself to that standard, not slipping away. Like, oh man, we've been friends or cousins or whatever for our whole entire life. And no, I don't care. It doesn't matter. Like, we are not riding unless, and it's not to put you on a pedestal by any means or anything like that. And I think there should be more conversations. I mean, we're doing it right now just by talking about it on the podcast, about having that conversation with your riding group. Because that's the best point, right? Like, if I, not that I know everything, I've taken, you know, the rescue and then the level one. So I have, we'll just call it X amount of knowledge about it, right? And I'm the one that's buried and you don't know anything and I'm depending upon you. That's like, that's scary, you know? That's, you know.
Well, and when I got my group, my buddies, I mean, they pushed back a little bit in the beginning, a couple of them did, but it's like, you know, you're doing this.
Yeah.
Like, you guys can all afford it. You're doing this. Like, I'll set the date. I'll do whatever, but you're doing it. So they went and did it. And I told them beforehand, I says, after you come out of this, you're going to be blown away and you're going to call me and you're going to be like, yeah, dude, we should have done that waste. Like, I had no idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not even exaggerating. Every one of them did it. I mean, the conversation, we went to lunch and they're like, we have no idea why. I mean, we didn't know what we thought we knew. It was the same for every single person. Like, we've been so lucky so many times in our lives riding in stuff that we shouldn't have been riding. We thought we knew what was dangerous. We didn't. You know, to the point where a couple of them were like, dude, thanks for making me do that type thing, right? Sure. And then the next part of it was, I want to learn more.
Mm-hmm.
So now we did a level twos and we did rescues. You know what I mean? We've, as a group, I had three level ones, three different rescues, a level two and a pro one. And I enjoy learning about it. Like, I've taken it further than I think most people need to, but it's part of it's because of my career.
Yeah.
But I mean, once you get your group started, it just snowballs
mm-hmm.
and it becomes interesting and it becomes fun. Mm-hmm. And, it's a big eye opener.
Yeah. One thing that I was super blown away, I've talked about it on the podcast before, but, you know, my whole life growing up in Montana and everything, like, I've always been just so obsessed with snow. Always. I love the cold. I love the snow, snowmobiling, all of it. And I could not believe how much wealth of knowledge that there was within the science of snow.
That's crazy.
It's insane. Like, I never would have thought all of these different things. Like, obviously I was blown away with like the understanding the beacon and how it works and, the bags and the making the riding plan and all that kind of stuff. I was blown away by several topics, but a big one that stood out was my total lack of knowledge around the science of snow. Like, it's really crazy. There's a lot to it for sure.
Yeah, and it's so weather-based. And the further I got into it, it's like, okay, to make decisions in my terrain, I don't necessarily have to know all the science stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if I understand the basics, that can help me make the decisions.
Sure.
You know, where we should be going, where we shouldn't be going, what days we should be going there. I mean, the avalanche report will tell you a lot.
Yeah.
And that's another thing that the Avalanche Alliance has really tried to focus on, is getting more avalanche information to the consumers, to the riders, via the forecast centers. So there's some areas that don't have a forecast. Island Park was a perfect example of that. Island Park's never had a forecast.
Okay.
It's and I learned some crazy stuff there the last couple of weeks ago. East Idaho, if I can remember the statistic right, East Idaho had more avalanche deaths than any other place in North America.
Really?
Yeah. Because we have a ton of mountains around us, and a lot of people come here from other places. You know, just between Island Park, Western Wyoming, Stanley, like, we had the highest number of deaths of anywhere in North America.
Hmm.
So, I don't know. It's real.
Yep.
Like, we got to recognize it, and we got to prepare ourselves. I heard an awesome comparison.
Hey, what's up, guys? Hope you're enjoying the show so far. Just want to take a quick second to introduce another one of this year's sponsors. We got RSI. So whether you need handlebars or grips, seat covers, controls, etc., doesn't matter. Use SledSend 2023 at checkout for 15% off your next order.
We started using this in our Avalanche Alliance presentations, but it's like flying a plane. You know, I can go buy an Avi bag, probe, shovel, beacon, just like I can go buy an airplane. I don't know how to fly an airplane.
Yeah.
I can buy one.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, if I'm dumb enough to try it, I could probably try to taxi it out on the runway and take it off, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a pretty dangerous thing to do, right?
Yeah.
Is it dangerous for us to think that we can go buy all this gear and go in the craziest mountains and think that we're going to know what to do with it, it's going to protect us, and we're going to be safe? It's really no different.
Yeah.
You know, it's dangerous to fly a plane if you don't know how to do it.
Yeah.
It's dangerous to go in the mountains and think you've got all this protective gear and don't know how to use it.
Yeah.
So, I'd have pilots in the crowd and they'd be like, uh-huh. You'd get the whole head shake thing. Or an electrician.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to go be an electrician with no training. Yeah, dude, you're probably going to die.
Yeah.
Like, we need training for different things for a reason. And avalanche, you know, backcountry riding is no different.
Yeah.
Then it gets to the point, you know, where you get the guy that's like, well, I know avalanche. I've been around those hills. You know, I just know not to ride on those. And it's like, well, it's not always those hills like you're saying that you're thinking about. Sometimes Mother Nature's got a plan that you don't, and you sure don't want to be caught in the middle of hers when you don't have a backup or any training.
Well, she's always got a plan. It just depends on if you're there and ready.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, Usually your plan isn't, they don't equal up too often.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that we're pretty passionate, you know, Klim's really passionate about the Avalanche Alliance. We're trying to make it an industry thing. We don't want it to be about Klim.
Yeah.
We've brought on, you know, Aerie's a great partner to that. They've done a lot to help us move the initiative forward. We donate, you know, between donating quite a bit of money to Aerie to do avalanche scholarships. And then last year we basically donated most of it to the forecast centers. This year we're going to donate some back to Aerie so scholarships for people can take training.
Mm-hmm.
I actually was a benefactor of one of those scholarships when I did my pro one. So, you know, we just want to see more companies get involved.
Yeah.
To help us get the word out. Snow West has been awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Ryan's been really supportive and helped us get the word out on that. With the truck, Wheel Pros kicked in a bunch. They've helped us. You're going to see this get more aggressive after the new year with the messaging.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Kind of get past the holidays, and then
we're
going to announce another competition too, a giveaway to Chili.
Okay.
We're going to encourage people to practice with their Avi gear and record it and then submit that, and that'll be an entry to give them. We're going to give a trip away to ride in Chili in July.
Oh, boy.
So that's Matt Ince, Dan Adams go down, get to ride with them for a few days, all expense paid trip. And all you got to do is show us practicing with your Avi gear that you know how to use it, where it is in your bag.
Mm-hmm.
You have your transceiver.
Wow, that's a great idea.
So we'll launch that competition here soon.
Nice.
Just trying to come up with ways to get people to be safer.
Yeah. Heck yeah.
No, is there any innovation coming or up and coming for Avalanche stuff, or is it pretty for equipment wise, or are we pretty set based as riders? You need a beacon and an Avi bag, and that's kind of what we've got.
You know, riders need five things. Not, I don't want to turn this into a training, but this is kind of the easy way. So you need a probe, a shovel, a transceiver, a bag, and a radio. It didn't used to be part of that, but the radio is a major part of it now. Dan had an experience a year ago, actually.
My friend was in that. That's my friend from Oregon, Primeville.
Really?
The kid that was in it.
Yeah.
His dad, Jim Valentine.
Yeah.
Yeah, and his boy. That was. Yeah.
So you know exactly what I'm talking about.
They came home. They called us, shaking on the phone. Jim goes, Cliff, to my dad, he goes, if we've done this for years, and he goes, it just happened to us with a professional, and he goes, I just scared the daylights out of me.
So there's a video of it. There's two videos. Dan has them. And in the video, Dan sees the avalanche coming, and he gets on his radio and says, avalanche, 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 pull your bags. And that's what got everybody in the group to pull their bag.
Mm-hmm.
And if Dan wouldn't have had a radio, they wouldn't have known, and it hit him in the back.
Sure.
So a radio is absolutely 100% a safety device, mm-hmm. and should be used.
Yep.
So,
yeah, that one was wicked. That was crazy. They went on a clinic over there with Dan, and they're right from Primeville, Oregon, right over there. And sure as heck, the boy is the one who got caught in it, and the dad was so shooken up over it. You know what I mean?
Oh, you should see the video.
Yeah,
it was the F bombs. We had to edit it.
Oh yeah,
I watched a whole lot to get the F bombs out.
When he goes to Jim, and Jim's sitting there red faced, all
yeah,
he's, like you said, he's spitting F bombs out.
And I mean, I don't blame the guy. Like
you just watch
your kid get punted down the hill, you know. But
gnarly.
And here's another real eye opener: is I was with Dan the first time he showed the video and talked through it, and he about didn't get through it.
Really?
Yeah. It shook him up too. You're responsible for clients.
Yeah.
They're in your zone. And you've been avalanche trained, you know, and these guys will tell you, like, we made a mistake. Like, we were someplace we shouldn't have been. I respect Dan a ton for being humble enough to admit that they made mistakes, and they're using it to educate and learn. Mm-hmm. I mean, he could try to hide that.
Yeah.
You know, it's embarrassing or whatever. No, dude. As hard as it is, he's like, learn from our mistake. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Like, it's still, even professionals still make mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Don't make, you know, learn from these mistakes, right? So I got a ton of respect for Dan and Matt because they've used those experiences to teach people. And Jim, too, because he agreed to let that video be shown.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. You know, I mean, those are hard things to watch.
And I know that for darn well, riding with him, you know, and from our that opened up so many eyes to, you know, his friends and then other people of him actually being with one of the industry leaders, you know, and it could still happen. Doesn't matter. Like, you just have no control over it. And he just basically said to everybody, he's like, you need.
But we do. We have control. We make the decisions on whether or not we put ourselves in those risks or not. Yeah. And so that's crazy. You know those guys. I mean, what a coincidence.
Yeah.
Like,
We ride with them all the time. And he got done that day and he left a big old voicemail with my dad. And you could tell he's just all plumb, just shook and straight, you know. And after there for a while, like you said, it was kind of hush-hush. They wasn't sure if they were going to, you know, what they were going to do with it or whatever. And then I think it's kind of gotten turned into a little bit of a, you know, learning lesson. So,
yeah.
It just shows it can happen at any time to anybody.
So, we'll just keep pushing on, keep trying to grow the Avalanche Alliance, bring on more partners, try to do more presentations and raise more money and get more forecasting centers. You know, I mean, just everything we can do.
Yep. Heck yeah. Absolutely.
If anybody listening to this, go to avalanchealliance.org. Please buy some sweepstakes tickets. I mean, that's a fundraiser that benefits you. Anyone in the snowmobile industry, because those dollars are going to forecast centers that you can use to look at the avalanche forecast.
Yep.
So it's one of the only times that a sweepstakes is going to directly benefit you, whether you win the truck or not.
Yeah.
I know a guy, he's already pitched $3,000 into it.
Sure.
Just because it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
Right? Because he enjoys the sport and he wants to support the cause.
And it'll help save a life.
Yeah, and he can afford it. So that's our goal, is just, you know, we want to earn $500,000 this year and donate it to Avalanche Forecast Centers and scholarships and just keep the ball rolling.
Heck yeah. I love it. I love what you guys are doing with that. Jeff, how are we on time? So we're getting close on that card. Okay, so let's...
I'm going to add one more thing about the truck.
Okay.
Sorry.
No.
I'm changing the vibe.
Tear it up.
So one really big partner we ended up getting on the truck was the Diesel Brothers.
Oh, really?
So we actually hauled the truck down to the Diesel Brothers. They built it.
No way.
Yep, and they brought it back up. And they're going to come out with a video on their channel talking about the truck and the importance of the Avalanche.
Oh, man. That's huge.
Yeah. They were so cool about it, too. Yeah. I mean, they were like...
I'm sure.
They're like, what can we do? Yeah. I mean, they didn't even, you know, it's just, and they're busy. I mean, they're go. They're always moving locations, you know, doing a recovery. And they're just like, just get it here. We'll figure it out. We'll work it in. In a week, they had it done. They called us. They brought it back up to us.
Yeah.
I mean, that's awesome.
That's huge.
You know, for them to do that.
Yeah.
So props to the Diesel Brothers. I just want to make sure that they get some credit because they went above and beyond.
That's awesome.
There's a lot of other people, too, that I don't name. I apologize, but there's a lot of people that have helped.
Yep, for sure. So. No, it's a great thing. Absolutely. That's an awesome topic. Let's kind of shift a little bit back towards you, Dustin. I had an individual hit me up on Instagram by the name of Troy, and he was talking to me about the Iron Dog, and he had said something that you were entering that this year.
Kind of.
Yeah. Let's get into it.
So I'm pretty fortunate. Klim is a sponsor of the Iron Dog race. We have been for a long time. If you don't know anything about the Iron Dog, go Google it. I think it's the world's toughest snowmobile race.
It's like 2,500 miles.
I was gonna say, give me a little breakthrough because I'm not going to Google it right now and I don't know.
So the Iron Dog is a cross-country race, literally 2,400 miles across Alaska and back. I mean, they cover like the whole state of Alaska pretty much. Mm. And you got to think about this for a second. It's in February. The most brutal conditions there are, you know, temperatures down to negative 60. They race across the Bering Sea. Yeah. Like these guys are running across sea ice, you know, and then they'll hit open water or whatever.
Yeah.
They do it in less than 7 days.
Yeah.
And the rules are, it's way cool the way they've got it set up. Like you're on the clock.
Yeah, yeah.
If you have to stop and work on your sled, you're on the clock.
On the clock.
Yeah. You know, they have an off day that they have to mandatory, can't think of the word, break day or whatever. And if they work on their sled on that day, they're on the clock. So there's a timekeeper there and he's like, okay, ready, go. Okay. If you got to change carbides, belt, whatever, you're on the clock. So that adds to your time.
Yep.
So you got that all like sitting there and you're like, all right.
Oh yeah. Right, like tools are ready. Yeah.
And you're like changing
NASCAR style.
Really?
Well, cause Troy was saying something about, like a free inspection period. Like you've got 10 minutes to look over your sled
and see what it
and
needs.
See what's going on and start making a list or whatever, and then put everything back on. And then when it's go time, you dive right in and fix all the stuff.
It's a team race. So by team race, meaning you've got two sleds, two drivers, and they race together at the same time. So it's not like you're trading off. Yeah. You're both on a...
Oh, really?
Yeah. So and both sleds have to survive the race. Whether you tow one across the finish line, it doesn't matter. You've got to get it across the finish line. Yeah. Oh, yeah. They've towed across the finish line. Yep. Yep. Last year, I think... One team towed across the finish line last year. Was it Team Chris and Mike? I can't remember now. I should know this. But anyways, that's a real deal. Like two guys on two sleds start, two guys on two sleds finish.
Yeah.
But the purse is huge. I mean, this is a big, like, they've had the grand, like the prize money is $100,000. Mm-hmm. You know, so they're split that up. Like, I think winners get like 45 or 50. I mean, it's, I don't know what it is this year, but it's.
How many sleds they got that.
So pro class is like 26 or 28 teams or something like that. We can pull it up. And then you've got what's called the expedition class, which is kind of like your amateur. Like I want to go ride the course, but I don't want to time.
Yeah.
So the expedition class is teams that are riding the Iron Dog course. They're just not timed.
Yeah.
And they still set goals. You know, they still have to move a certain distance and things like that. What's crazy is you get out in these villages, and I don't know that much about Alaska. I got to go up there last year and experience it. I got to ride a little bit and meet a lot of people and work, you know, meet the board of the Iron Dog, and they taught me a lot. But it's what's interesting, and I didn't know this, there's no roads from village to village.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to go from a village, and, you know, most of Alaska, excuse me, it's just villages. Yeah. I mean, you've got Anchorage, you got Fairbanks, you got, you know, there's the towns,
sure.
But you get away from that, it's villages. And the only way to get to them is on a snowmobile or an airplane. In the summer, it's a boat or an airplane. And when I say airplane, they don't, it's not like you go get on a commercial jet and fly in.
Yeah, no.
Like they're flying around Cubs.
Mm. Two to three seats max.
Yeah, they use an airplane like a car. Yeah. And they just land them wherever they want.
Yeah.
You know, they land them on a gravel bar. They land them in a field. They land, it doesn't matter. You know, it's just like, oh, I'm going to drive down this dirt road to get to my buddy's house. Well, that's the way they fly a plane.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and I didn't know that. And so the reason Iron Dog, you know, it's kind of like it's kind of designed after the Iditarod.
Yeah.
But it's in Alaska, a snowmobile is a basic form of transportation.
Sure.
Just like a car.
Mm-hmm.
Your high school team's going to go play the neighboring high school team in volleyball. You're riding there on a snowmobile.
Yeah.
That's the way it works. There's, mm-hmm. They were telling us stories of riding 12 hours on a snowmobile for a basketball game.
Oh.
I had no idea. Like, you know how spoiled we are?
Yeah.
How like, spoiled they are?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well.
Ride a snowmobile from school to your games?
Right. Yeah. But, I mean, it's just a different way of life that we don't really know.
Yeah.
And I'm so, I can't tell you how excited I am. So I'm not in the pro class. I'm not racing. What they did is they've invited some, it's called an ambassador team.
Right.
So myself, Chris Kaltenbacher, Smasher,
mm-hmm.
Roger Brown, who is a board member on the Iron Dog, Mike Buck, who's a very big avalanche and safety promoter up in Alaska, got a ton of experience. Haven't met him. I'm looking forward to meeting him. Our job is going to be to ride from village to village and do safety presentations, because one of the issues they have up there, from what I've been told, because a snowmobile is like a basic form of transportation, they don't wear helmets.
Yeah.
So they're putting on their fur hats, you know, mm-hmm. and their goggles, and they're going out and they're just riding them around every day. And probably so
high speeds too, and getting
probably, places. You know, and so the safety thing, they're really trying to promote safety amongst these villages. And we have the opportunity. Iron Dog's bought a bunch of helmets. They've purchased a bunch of helmets. And I think some other people have donated some too, if I heard right. But there's like 600 or 800 helmets, and they're going to fly them in. And then us as ambassadors, we get to do some safety presentations at a school.
Oh, that's cool.
And then we're going to give out some helmets in a few places. Then we're going to go to the next village. So our course is 1800 miles. Actually, I think Smasher and Roger are running the whole thing. I got to fly out. I'm going to fly home out of Nome. So we'll leave Big Lake, which is like a little over an hour and a half away from Anchorage, run up to Kotzebue, and then come back down to Nome, and then there's like a halfway banquet.
Yeah.
So we'll stay and do the halfway banquet, and then I have to fly home because I've got a photo shoot I got to be back for. But I think they're going to finish racing or running the rest of the course.
Yeah.
So we'll do 1,800 miles, but we'll do it. It's 6 days.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
Like, that's crazy. My butt's not ready for that yet.
Yeah,
like,
no.
So on these races, like for the race one or whatever, is it, I mean, are these like, I don't know, like, I don't think Keith Curtis does this, does he?
No. Iron Dog is a very unique
task. Is there like special Iron Dog racers, just straight up Iron Dog racers?
Oh, yeah.
Or
these are most of them are
hilltime racers that go and do this? Is there any mountain guys that go do this?
No.
Do you have to qualify for this? Is there races leading up? Do you just enter with your sled and you?
You have to enter. It's a big race. It's a lot of work. So you have to enter like months and months in advance. I mean, they've already closed the entries for this year. It's mostly native Alaskans that race it. There are some people that come from the lower 48 and go up and race it. There's Gata Tahoe, Dave Wagner. There's some guys out of Utah that'll run it. There's a couple Midwestern guys that'll run it. But I'd say, I'm just going to guess 85 or 90% are native Alaskans or local Alaskan citizens. Quite a bit of the expedition class comes in. There's a big group of like 10 or 15 guys that come in from the East Coast and rent sleds and do it. There's actually a guy that's kind of got a business set up to where he has sleds ready to go, and they've got lodging, and you come in and they've got, you know, you run the whole thing, and you know, you kind of pay a fee, kind of a cool experience thing. But it's a lot of work. They have to organize lodging for all of us. I mean, we're out in these villages, and you stay with villagers.
Yeah.
There's no hotel.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, it's like you're on a couch and you're eating at their house. And they love it.
Yeah, sure.
You know, they love it. It's like the thing they look forward to all year. It's the biggest event in Alaska.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, it's, and so just the culture, I can't wait. I'm nervous. I'm hearing the like temperatures of negative 30, negative 40, and I'm like, what did I just get myself into? Yeah, like, Idaho weather is not bad compared to that.
Yeah.
But I'm super excited. John did it last year. I had an entry and I wasn't able to go, and John went, and he came back with just some cool stories. He's like, dude, it'll blow your mind. It's like the scenery is out of this world. So, and the people, I've gotten to know a lot of the racers, and they're awesome people. I mean, the culture of Alaska, dude, they'll help anybody. They're just nice people. They care about people. It's like, it's kind of like the old West where it's like, oh, you got your friends and your neighbors and your relatives, right? Yeah. And so every racer's reaching out, hey, what can I do to help you? Like, you need tracks, you need gear, you need a sled. Like, they're being super helpful.
I don't know where that came from.
But. Yeah, I don't. You can, if you want to push down on that light switch, they should all go off.
What kind of sleds are they racing?
So they're crossover sleds.
They got to be 600s too, don't they?
Yeah, Polaris makes a special cross country race sled. They call it the cross country, and they either do cross country races in the Midwest or they ship some up to the Iron Dog and run them up there. Skidoo has one as well. So they're like a 137 track. You know, like 1¾ lug, studs. They stud them up down the center, 2 studs per.
So, like, how hard would that be? How hard would that be for somebody like me to enter that race? Is it kind of impossible? You got to be like big sponsored up to do it, or what?
It's expensive. I mean, you would want sponsors. Honestly, you'd probably. I can't talk from experience. Mm-hmm. I haven't done it.
Sure,
but I'm assuming based off what I've been told, you'd want to go run like the expedition class first.
Yeah,
and just get some experience.
Yeah,
and then if you wanted to race, you gotta have a partner. Mm-hmm. The entry fees are, I mean, they're made to get you to commit, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's like $4,200 or something per person, or 30. I don't remember. It's in that area.
Yeah.
And then you're gonna want sponsors, because it's, you know, you gotta have a sled. You gotta have the sled there. I mean, you gotta get there. You know.
Yeah.
And it's a commitment. It's mm-hmm. a big commitment. These guys train most of the season for
that's what I've also wondered too. I'm like, man, how is there a big disadvantage for the guys that are up in Alaska and they get to run that same
I think there's course? A pretty good advantage for the locals, yeah.
Because they get to be up there just every day.
Well, like, and like Mike, and he's from Nome. He knows all that terrain, right? He knows what it's like. He grew up in it. So, I mean, I'm sure there's some advantages to being, you know, from those areas.
Oh, yeah.
There's some... Tyler, I think he's from Nome too. He ran with John last year. He's a younger guy that's a native, you know, from out in one of the villages, and he was stupid. John said he was just stupid fast.
Hmm.
He's like, what you and I think is fast is not fast.
Yeah.
Huh. Like, these guys are taking 2-foot moguls at 85 miles an hour.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
It doesn't even faze him.
Yeah.
Huh. So I'm like, maybe I should be nervous. I don't know. But I'm excited.
Yeah, I'm excited for you. It'll be interesting to see how it goes for you.
And you can track it. They all run GPS trackers, so you can actually get on the Iron Dog website and see real-time tracking.
Oh, nice.
It's pretty cool the way they do it.
Heck yeah.
Yeah.
Nice. So I just got a signal from Jeff. We're about out of memory on the cards and stuff. So, Dustin, the thing that Kobe was referring to that I didn't tell you about. So at the end of every single episode, I know this is a two-part, but we did do it on the part one. We always asked the guest to ask a sled talk question for the listeners and the viewers. And so obviously we've done several episodes. So it can be about anything. It can be something as simple as like, have you ever taken an avalanche course? It could be like, why climb? It could be like, you know, your favorite backcountry snack. Like, it could be anything within the space of something that you would
I
like
did
to
blue
ask.
Jeans or sweats? Yeah. That was my question. A lot of sweats.
Because it works, you know, people want to always want to comment their opinions, right? So we cut it up as a little clip and it works well on TikTok and whatnot. So anything, it doesn't have to be anything specific to climb. It could be whatever a sled talk question that you would like to ask the listeners and viewers.
Oh, wow. So I got to decide, do I want something serious or something funny? let's see. Yeah, you do two? All right, we'll do one of each then.
Okay.
So we'll start out with the serious one. I think my serious one is, you know, there's a lot of things that threaten our riding areas.
Yep.
A lot of politics. And the power sports industry is not always real good about getting involved. Mm-hmm. Like, we need to be more involved with clubs and organizations that fight for our right to ride in our riding area. So I think one question I would ask is, what are you doing to protect your riding areas? And what are you doing to make it so that we can continue to ride in our riding areas and maybe gain more riding areas?
Yep.
Awesome. What are you a part of? What extra thing are you doing?
Right? That's a great question. Awesome question.
So that would call probably be answer. My serious question.
Okay. The next one.
How many people ride in blue jeans?
Yeah, it's been a while.
There's only one legend in that.
What are you riding in for a base layer if it's not blue jeans?
Good question. Comment your guys' answers below. So we'll wrap this episode up. Dustin, thank you so much for your hospitality today, the tour this morning, and jumping on a couple episodes.
Glad you guys came.
Yeah, likewise. We appreciate it a ton. So, Kobe, did you have any final words?
Just pretty blown away, man. If you have any doubts on climb, you can come ask me, and I got some reassuring.
You're like the new advocate?
I got some reassuring things that I've learned today.
No money changed hands.
No. It was all seen with my eyes. That was it.
That's good. I'm glad.
Pretty good company around here, and you're a pretty good guy. Thanks for coming. Us around.
Yeah. Appreciate it.
Heck yeah. Awesome. Sled Talk listeners, thank you guys for tuning in. Whether you're on podcast platforms or watching on the YouTube channel, appreciate you guys being here. And we'll see you guys on the next one. Protect, believe, living life with no regrets. I can't design it when I get dressed. Hey. Summertime on winter fresh. Fresh. I put her legs behind her head. Night, night, she gonna bed. Bye-bye. Every day it's a new test. I just keep chasing these chicks.